and celebrate graduations, and really transitions of all types. Transitions are kind of interesting. We all go through them many times. Some we plan for carefully and eagerly look forward to, like graduations, new jobs. Others seem to just happen to us. The sale of a company that we work for, a divorce, the loss of a loved one. While all transitions are different, one thing they have in common is that we experience a sense of uncertainty, which can be energizing, but also anxiety-producing. We don't know what to expect next. We're not sure exactly how we're going to handle whatever it is, and sometimes we may even be afraid that we won't be able to. I remember that prior to having my first child, I was pretty sure I knew what it was going to be like to become a mom. I read What to Expect When You're Expecting, lots of books on parenting, plus I had friends with kids, and I had practically raised my little brother, at least in my own mind. And then my son was born, and it was both the happiest and most terrifying day of my life to that point. The good news, we all survived. My son is now 27. But I can honestly say that I still find navigating transitions challenging, even ones that I look forward to. Which is why I think that today's text from 1 Samuel is so well suited for a day when we're lifting up transitions. Today's scripture marks the beginning of a time of transition for Samuel, for Eli, and eventually for all of Israel. It's not one that they necessarily saw coming, so they probably weren't quite prepared. And it certainly was not without challenge. Now, to fully appreciate and relate to the challenge, I need to rewind the story a little bit. At the opening of the book of Samuel, Israel is in a state of crisis, a time of great instability. It's not yet a fully formed nation, but rather a loose federation of tribes, and they don't have a clear leader, and they're feeling the pain of that lack of leadership. Additionally, Israel is experiencing external and internal threats. Externally, the militarily superior Philistines pose a very real threat to their national security. And internally, they are plagued by the corruption of the priestly house of Eli. Now, as the priest at Shiloh, Eli was the protector of the Ark of the Covenant, the symbol of God's presence in the midst of God's people. However, Eli's sons had corrupted the religious practices of Israel for their own gain. Now, Eli tried to talk sense into them to get them back on the right path, but they wouldn't listen. And so, as was noted by Sally at the beginning of our scripture for today, the word of the Lord was rare in those days. Or said differently, it seems that God had stopped speaking to God's people. Now we know from the scripture, however, that that perception wasn't totally true. God speaks to Samuel, and with Eli's help and guidance, Samuel chooses to listen. It's perhaps not surprising that although this appeared to be a truly God-forsaken time, God was still present. Nor is it particularly surprising that God chose a naive and innocent child with whom to initiate conversation. It is, however, very surprising that without the guidance from a flawed mentor, Samuel would have never figured out that it was God's voice speaking to him. Sometimes it's easy for us to assume that only those of us who are good and pure and godly are positive contributors to God's work in the world. But this story reminds us that each of us has a role to play. The biggest surprise, though, is what came next. After Samuel chose to reply to God as instructed by Eli, "Speak, for your servant is listening." Now, it's worth noting that listening is not something that just happens. That would be hearing. Listening is an active process in which a conscious decision is made to listen and understand the messages of the speaker. So Samuel makes the choice to listen to God and gets much more than he bargained for. God tells Samuel that Eli and Eli's family are utterly corrupt and will be killed. God doesn't say how or when it will happen, but makes it clear that it will happen, and that Israel will begin the transition to a new and hopefully better model of leadership. Now, I'm guessing that at least for a moment, and maybe more, Samuel was wondering, what did he get himself into? He didn't ask for this. He didn't ask to be part of God's plan in that way. But he did make the choice to listen to God's message. And now he must find the courage to give voice to it. Scripture tells us that Samuel lay in the bed after his talk with God, no doubt tossing and turning. He was probably feeling a mixture of excitement and anxiety. After all, God had spoken to him, called him by name even, and given him a glimpse of the future. How cool is that? But the context of the message, and the content of the message, was the cause of his anxiety. His natural instinct was likely to run and discuss the event with Eli, but given what the message said, he was afraid. So Samuel tried to do what many of us do when we're facing an uncomfortable situation. He tried to avoid it. Once again, though, Eli proves to be a great mentor, and he compels Samuel to tell him everything that God has said, word for word, without any softening of the message. And when it was over, Eli affirmed Samuel for listening to God and being receptive to what God told him. The transition had officially begun. According to our text, God continued to talk to Samuel as he grew up, and Samuel continued to listen and to respond to God, resulting in changes for Samuel, Eli, and the whole of the people of Israel. A huge amount of change that started with a simple but courageous choice to listen and respond. Over the past year or so, I've felt a growing sense of crisis in our country, a state of instability. Now, our political situation is very different from that of ancient Israel, but we are facing a mounting number of internal challenges. Some days, it seems as if our leaders have forgotten how to lead, and we've forgotten how to care for each other, how to be good stewards of creation, and love our neighbors. It almost feels as if God has stopped speaking to us and we've been left alone to figure out how to get out of this mess on our own. But we know in our hearts that's not true. God is still with us. God is always with us. In good times, bad times, stable times, and times of transition. And God is still speaking. So our job, our challenge, is to choose to discern what God is calling us to do as a community and as individuals, and then have the courage to respond, to speak out, to act, to stand up with those who are fighting the good fight so they know that they are not alone, and to stand up for those who can't. Unimaginable levels of change can result when we choose to listen and respond to God's call to engage in making the world a better place, a safer place, a more just place. Me Too, Black Lives Matter, March for Our Lives. Those are all national examples, but we have many examples right here in our own congregation. The Green Team, helping us to create a more sustainable and healthy planet, not just for us, but for all of those who come beyond us that we will never even meet. The 2% Fund, helping to eradicate homelessness the best way that we can. Cluster Tutoring, helping to give back and foster education and hope in young people, again, many of whom which we might never have normally encountered. And Sacred Conversations on Race, a brave and bold conversation to have, particularly at this time in our country. And most recently, the beautiful rainbow doors on the front lawn that make a proactive, unmistakable public statement to all that drive by. God is still speaking, and like Samuel, we are called to listen and speak the truth, even when it frightens us. We are blessed to be part of a community that chooses to listen and has the courage to respond. Together, we may just change the world. Amen.